Hi, everyone.
Hi, I'm Curtis.
Hi, I'm Morris.
Whoa. You know, Curtis, the Worm community has been coming to UCLA now for more than 10 years.
Whoa, 6 international meetings. You know, the same beautiful dorm rooms with cable TV.
The same really long walks between buildings.
Yeah, extra long detours, you know. And the bright California sun, nice.
And the same smog.
You know, and being so close to Hollywood, okay, there's always the prospect for an exciting extreme celebrity death watch with helicopters hovering overhead, televising aerial shots of UCLA Medicare Center, just like last time.
Really? I thought that was live coverage for the Worm meeting.
Yeah, right, right.
Well, then there's the food at the Commons, especially the soft serve ice cream.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, keeping one's body mass index steady at a meeting like this is a careful balance between what you eat at the Commons
and how much exercise you get walking from the plenary sessions to the parallel sessions to the posters to the dorms and back again.
You know, I wonder, do you think you could buy a soft serve ice cream maker for the lab?
Could I charge it to my NSF grant? How would I justify the expense?
Well, let me see. You could put it down as a piece of essential media preparation equipment. All you would need is to find a nematode that will feed on frozen dairy dessert ice cream food-like product.
Maybe you could put it under the broader impacts as nutritional supplement for graduate students. Broader impacts. I'd love to be just completely honest with broader impacts one of these years.
Yeah, you mean like, if I get this grant, I get to keep the house that I bought at the top of the market. That's $100,000 underwater.
Or if I get this grant, I get to teach only 3 classes this year instead of 5.
Oh, but Morris, I thought you liked teaching.
Yeah, sure. In winter, I had a biology class with 560 students in it.
Oh. So how do you teach that many people?
Well, it's quite the challenge. Most of them were either texting or were on Facebook.
Oh. You mean like the people down there right now? The ones, they're either texting or on Wormbook.
Right. Well, actually, one of the keys to teaching well is to be believable. The students need to trust you.
Yeah, you know, I was thinking about that. Do you get any inspiration from the Worm meeting?
Well, sure. Oh, yes. Have you ever noticed how the talks given by people from the United Kingdom are much more believable?
At least
to an American.
Americans, you know, Anglophiles. But, you know, the Queen's English. So what you're saying is, if, for example, you know, I said instead, like in a strong Southern accent, aliens have been visiting America for over 50 years, that you could make it more believable by using a different accent.
Yeah, that's an easy one. For example, extraterrestrials have been visiting the United States for more than 50 years.
BBC. I guess that's sort of like linguistic epistasis.
Right. So from time to time, I adopt a British accent if I want the students to pay attention.
You know, I wonder, maybe this could work in papers. You could have put a footnote on that says, when you read this paper, in your mind, imagine the voice of Jonathan Hodgkin.
Or maybe Mario De Bono.
But, you know, the real problem, at least for me, I don't know you, the real problem is whenever I start to do a British accent, if I'm not careful, I break into Monty Python.
No one expects the Spanish Inquisition.
It's only a flesh wound.
It's a dead parrot.
Oh, she turned me into a newt. Okay, no. Well, so I'm looking around and saying, okay, all the old people got the Monty Python jokes. A lot of young people out there.
So how many people here by your applause are at your first Worm meeting? Wow.
Yeah, okay. So a lot of newbies. Makes me feel nostalgic and old. Okay. You know, that some of the notebooks...
Are you saying? Because you are.
Okay, yeah, like some of the notebooks in my lab are older than people in my lab. Okay. It's true.
You know, when I think about when I started working on worms 20 years ago, remember when you first put a worm into a flame and how there's that first moment of like this is murder.
Yeah, but you know, after a week, you're just flaming things right up.
Ever flame like so many worms at once that this lump of carcasses just flies off the pick?
Yeah, and you know, around your Bunsen burner, there's all these little specks of carbonized worms.
Remember how scared you were when you first saw a mite?
Oh, God, you've seen mites, right? I mean, absolutely. I had the magnification really high on the dissecting scope, and it completely filled the field. It was like this enormous spiny monster. I practically jumped out of my skin.
Actually, you know what? We're not really supposed to be chatting. We have a worm show to actually
do. Oh, jeez, we got to do worms.
Oh. We maybe better get started. Okay.
Okay, hang on. Let's do that. Okay, you can bring the house lights up now.
I can't read my script. There it is. Welcome to our program of parody.
And music.
Celebrating the things that make our line of work so enjoyable.
So this year we've incorporated contributions made by some of you out there at this meeting in what we call WormTube.
So sit back and enjoy.
You know, G. Morris, I hope we don't have any computer problems like we did at the beginning of the show last year.
Yeah, let's hope not. I'm running Office 2010 now, so I think it's going to be just fine. Uh-oh.
Okay, just hit cancel, okay?
Yeah,
hit cancel.
Wow. They really built a lot of features into that thing, didn't they?
Okay, so our show, the first segment of the show is brought to you by the Swiss Army Knife for Worm Researchers.
And Snorg Tees, which is, this is real, actually.
Yeah, this is actually for real. And the new movie, Subterranean Worms from Hell, starring Helicephalopolis, however you say that, Mephisto. So, you know, Morris, at the last meeting, you noticed a correlation between the number of abstracts at worm meetings and the worm shows, and that it looked like the worm shows were causing the decline of the worm meeting. So I was wondering, what does the trend show with this year,
data? I'm happy to report that the data are looking much better this year.
Okay, so maybe the trend is reversed. We're not destroying the worm meeting.
Well, I think it may have something to do with our ability to predict the future.
Yeah.
So remember when we predicted Andy Fire's Nobel Prize?
Yeah, that was pretty good. Now, are you saying that something else we predicted came true? I mean, don't tell me Marty Chalfie's skin has turned green or something.
No, but during our 2005 segment on new papers for C. elegans researchers, we made a joke that there would be a new journal called Worm.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah, and now Harold Hutter has announced the new journal, Worm, coming out next year. So, Harold, you out there? Is this for real?
Is this for real?
Yeah.
Okay.
Whoa.
Well, I guess there's still hope for the Journal of Arnie Ice Creams.
You know, Morris, I think it's only fair before we continue that we tell everyone something that's been weighing heavily on our minds.
Curtis and I have a confession to make.
We've been seeing another community.
We were really lonely and you were working really long hours. Okay, well, it turns out we were invited by Marty Chalfie to give a show as part of Columbia University's celebration of 100 years of fly genetics.
So.
It's okay.
So, you know, Thomas Hunt Morgan started his fly room right around the turn of the last century, okay? Discovered the wide-eyed mutant, the beginnings of modern genetics, 1910, okay? So.
Well, here's a little video of our trip. Just to give you a sense
of where it's weird, you know, we're... Sorry, we're showing you a fly show at a worm show.
Yeah, we apologize for that.
Oh,
day.
Our name's the Sidney Brenner's name.
New York, New York.
Come on, it's Marty Chalfie.
I asked him where the upper
Sorry,
they have better mutant names.
They
I'm sorry.
They have better mutant names.
Oh. Confession is good for the soul, Curtis.
Yeah, yeah, sometimes
so
you gotta.
We promise it'll that never this is never again. Gonna happen again. Okay. Our next segment.
Am I here?
Where am I?
No.
Oh, next page.
No,
yes, next page.
Okay. Right. Okay, our next segment is brought to you by
UGG, tryptophan boots.
You know, that reminds me. You know, I think there's another company that makes UGA boots.
Oh, why, Curtis? That's just nonsense.
Ooh, and also brought to you by the Neural Network.
So every year, the meeting organizers have the difficult job of sifting through many abstracts to decide on which are good enough to be talks.
Yeah, you know, with some abstracts, decision might be easier than for others.
So we present some of the talks that were not selected for this year's Worm meeting.
Unexpected appearance of Sidney Brenner in Southern Blot. Scientists are coming from all across the country to worship.
HTTP 404, the missing gene. It's gone.
Portal 2 in co-op mode is not a research collaboration.
Right, so don't put that in your grant.
RNA interference around the world.
In Canada, it's RNA-E.
RNA-I.
In France, it's RNA-E.
RNA-E-E-E.
Dan Unda, it's RNA-I.
Biology education, how students view exams.
You know it's true. Human mortality studies, death by homeotic asphyxiation. That'll be funnier later when you realize what I'm referring to.
People that use Selexa sequencing, the Illuminati.
Spice up trivial data with graphics.
I don't know what it has to do with science, but you know, what the heck.
That's data.
A human heterochronic lineage mutant.
Bizarre recursive phenotype.
Why do biotech ads get DNA wrong? I mean, after all, it's not like, you know, the data is really new.
Yeah,
it's been around for what?
58 years. Civility in the workplace.
This is real.
Yeah. It's terrible, just terrible.
Science is my religion, the Sistine Chapel.
I love that one. Spock 1 inhibits cell death. Live long and prosper.
Mod explode. Blowing up model organisms. Note there is no worm.
Other model organisms.
Other. Yeah. Other.
Most deaf. It's not a technique. It's my name.
Hey, wormers, let's use Roman numerals. Dumpy XVVIII.
Unk CXIX. And finally, if worms could send tweets.
Start at the bottom.
You start at the bottom and read up. Yeah, okay. Okay. So our next segment is brought to you by ATP Energy Drink.
Skip oxidative phosphorylation and get what you really need.
And the Tony Award-winning Broadway musical,
The Book of Mormon. It won all the Tonys, right?
So, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to present to you a musical story of struggle and redemption. I give you Bohemian Rhapsody.
Is this sea elegance or a Diplo castorin caught on a world plate? No escape from geneticism. Open the lab, look under the scope and see. Just a postdoc, I need no sympathy. Because I'm working hard, night and day, little sleep, little pay. Anywhere the worm goes, pastor really matters to me.
Okay, our next bit is brought to you by the base pair matching necklaces.
Choose yours based on the nature of the relationship. A warning, you might not want to go and buy them individually, just in case you have to form a wobble pair.
Yeah, could be different. Yeah. And the Academy Award-winning movie, The King's Lab Doc.
So we all know how specialized knowledge is in the worm field.
Yep. What do you mean? What, you saying I can't like walk up to anyone on the street and ask them who Andy Fire is.
Well, to see just how specialized our field is, my former student Melissa Antonio and I ventured out into the UC Riverside campus to ask some students about genes and worms. We kind of also encouraged them to make something up if they didn't know, but this is what we got.
You guys are undergraduates here at UCR?
Yep.
We are.
What are you guys studying?
English.
Pre-business.
I'm actually biology majors.
Oh, you're bio majors?
Yeah.
I'm an entomology major.
A media and cultural studies.
Business economics.
Political science.
Creative writing.
Sociology and administrative study.
Sociology.
I'm a double major, psychology and sociology.
Math right now, but I'm going to plan on being a biology major.
I'm a graduate student. Use yeast as a model organism.
What do you think DNA is?
DNA.
DNA is like, it's what, I know the A, C, G.
Yeah.
Deoxynucleic acid.
Right.
Deoxyribonucleic
yes,
acid.
Yes, exactly. You got it.
Isn't it like,
for
deoxynucleic
acid.
Acid. Everybody has DNA. They're all different.
They're all different. Any idea what it stands for?
It's like I don't know how to say it, actually. It's long.
DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid.
Awesome.
What are genes?
Genes. Well, genes are what makes up your characteristics or your features, basically.
Yeah, like your eyes or stuff.
Yeah.
Okay. It's our DNA. It's our genetic makeup.
Good.
Genes, I mean, they make up the code of what we are.
Okay.
So, I mean, specifically...
Any examples?
Genes. I just took genetics. I mean, they make up everything. There are our genetic code that's self-replicating, made by DNA.
It's what's passed down, like, in your family. Like,
yeah.
Nematodes. You know what nematodes are?
It's a nematode.
Any guesses?
A nematode.
Nematodes are like kind of like bacteria, right? Am I right?
Bacteria.
Small little things. I'm not sure. Like, kind of like single cellular organisms, right?
Okay, single cellular. Actually, they're like multicellular organisms.
Are they like diploblastic or small organisms with like?
Nematodes are like worms or something like that, right?
Nematodes, little worms in the ground. I haven't done too much work on them, but
bacteria or something?
No, they're
a what?
That sounds like a frog, honestly.
It sounds like a frog.
Nematodes sound like frogs, but...
Does C. elegans ring a bell?
Nope.
No.
C. what?
C. elegans? No.
I don't know it.
No.
No, any ideas? Any ideas?
C. elegans? Not sure.
Inside plants.
Inside plants?
Yeah, C. elegans, I believe they are wrong ones. Nematodes.
Any idea what GFP is?
GFP.
I've never heard of GFP.
Any guesses?
Any
guesses?
No.
Probably had nothing to do with your genes.
GFP, I gotta go to class.
I don't know. GFP? No. GFP.
General? No. Gene? Frequency? No.
I've never heard of that.
Never heard of it. Any guesses of what it might be?
GFP?
Yeah.
Genetics.
Generic.
I don't know.
GFP is green fluorescence protein, so it's I believe they are extracted from jellyfish, I believe, and it will grow when you shine a fluorescent sun.
Who's Sydney Brenner?
Sydney Brenner.
Stupid.
Nah, I'm not good with people.
She wrote a book on the environment.
She wrote a book on environment?
Did she?
She's not the Secretary of State, right?
She's not the Secretary of State. No, she's not. No, actually.
Snowboarder, but.
Snowboarder, no.
I've never heard of her.
No.
Her? What is she?
Sydney Brenner?
I don't know. What about Craig Mello? Ever heard of Craig Mello?
No, I haven't heard of her. No. It sounds familiar, but not too sure.
Craig Mello? No.
Sounds familiar at all?
No.
Thank you guys so much for your participation. Problem. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Okay. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
That was my student, Melissa Antonio, who did that. Thank you, Melissa. Our next segment is brought to you by Einhard Schillenberg's Worm Pasta Sauce.
Ausgezeichnet, es ist lecker, lecker, schmecker.
Hey, das geht ab.
And the, oh, that's you.
And the movie Green Fluorochrome. Next, we'd like to tell you, through video, a story of life in the lab, as might be seen on a major television network. Well, this has been one of the busiest years ever. Committee work, teaching, I'm finally getting back into the lab. I'm gonna do something I've been planning to do all year, which is to build this plasmid. Mind the gap.
Definitely say it's a fun lab. Last Christmas, Morris made us go caroling.
Laughing all the way up on the stream, making spirits bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleighing song tonight. Whoa, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in one horse open sleigh. Hey, jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. Oh, what fun it is to ride a one-horse open sleigh.
You seen the email I guess?
Nope.
Do you want to do it? The why is this?
I don't know.
Any idea, Julian?
I don't know.
No questions.
Where's the DNA ligase?
Did you check the freezer?
Yeah, I checked the freezer.
Both freezers?
When Morris wants to do experiments in lab, we hide things because we do not want Morris to do experiments in lab.
I couldn't find anything to do my cloning experiment. No enzymes, no ligase. I don't know, I think something's going on. Anyway, I can't worry about it right now because I have to give lab meeting. So I don't have anything to talk about. So I'm gonna do what sometimes PIs have to do. You've got to go in there and give an inspirational speech so that you can get those students motivated. Because we've added a little something to this month's research contest. First prize, as you all know, is an iPod Classic. Anyone want to see second prize? Second prize is a box of pipette tips. Third prize is your fire.
From time to time, Morris does this thing from a 1992 movie, Glengarry Glen Ross. Yeah, I was like four.
You got the RNA-seq results. You can't clone those genes, you can't clone crap, you are crap, hit the bricks and beat it because you are going out.
The alleles are weak.
The alleles are weak? The freaking alleles are weak? You're weak. I can take the genes that you're given and go in the lab tonight, in 2 hours, tonight, and sketch out three papers. Can you do that? Can you do that? You think this is abuse? You think this is abuse? If you can't take this, how can you take the abuse you get from reviewers? A, always B, B, C, cloning. Always be cloning. Always be cloning. AIDA, attention, interest, decision, action. Attention, do I have your attention? Interested, are you interested? I know you are, because it's publish or perish. Decision, have you made your decision for science? And action.
I have no idea what that lab meeting was about.
It's difficult to get research done because there are so many distractions. Mutants. Angry Birds. Lady Gaga. Donna! Ooh! Perfluorocarbon emulsion and fluorine 19 nuclear magnetic resonance. Wow. All right, it's a new day. Gotta get in the lab and do that plasmid. Oh, wait a second. I gotta Skype Curtis.
So, we've been on the Skype for, what, 4 hours now?
Libya, Bolivia, Morneliette, Oreador, en garde. Last exgenomicus proteome, elegans.
Let's talk postdoc projects.
Okay.
I think we need to study the reception of pain.
Pain reception, that's a plausible subject.
Yep.
Have you considered Prosteoncus specificus?
We're gonna need to prepare a particular type of plate.
Some type of poison, or?
No, not poison, I was thinking something spicy. And you know, a good cheap source of spice is peppers. We'll need to pour a plethora of pepper plates to screen for pain reception in Prosteoncus pacificus.
Sounds perfect.
Potentially.
Probably.
Possibly.
That project's fat. Spelled with a P. Sometimes Morris goes off on these tangents and I just let him go.
So the key, I think, is to work together. There's no I in collaboration.
There's an I in Shun.
Well, what is it that people say there's no I in?
I think it's team.
There's no I in team?
There's a me, though. Does that count?
Hey, Jeanette.
Oh, hey, Melissa. So have you seen Morris today?
Oh, yeah, he's in his office, but he's in a really bad mood.
Oh, must be one of those experiments that didn't work.
Bad day in the lab today. First, I spilled a whole box of pipette tips.
Man.
Then I ran a gel backwards.
Scheiße.
And then I suspended my DNA in bleach.
This is bleach. Chick shock sauce doku.
Tomorrow, first thing, I'm gonna ask my undergraduate Crystal to take over this project. You're going to digest it with two restriction enzymes. You're gonna run it out of gel. Then you're gonna cut out the smaller product and gel purify. Sound good, Crystal?
My name's not Crystal, it's Heather.
That's what I said.
No, you didn't. You said Crystal.
I have a faculty meeting I have to go to, so I'll catch up with you after you're done.
I told him like 1,000 times my name's Heather. It's been 2 years.
Come and have a look at this.
Wow, what's up?
I got this serious postdoc request. Check it out. Plant pathogens. Oh, this is gonna be great.
This is a chain letter. This guy just probably sent an email out to 1,000 PIs. I mean, look,
what are you talking about?
Your name's in a different font.
I'm emailing them. So I contacted that postdoc and he wanted my credit card information. You know, I sent it, but that turned out not to be a good idea. Hey, Shruti, is now a good time to look at those Unc mutants to rescue?
Sure, yeah.
Great.
How about Unc 22?
Unc 22. Well, that might work, except that it takes up some 40,000 base pairs of coding sequence.
Wow. I didn't expect it to be that big.
That's what she said.
Hey!
So how's Morris's plane project?
You know, it turns out that he actually made that plasmid ages ago, so I'm just gonna thaw it and give it to Heather and she can digest it and present him with the data. He's gonna think she's a cloning genius.
Nice work.
Yeah.
Well, it's been a great week. Finally got my plasmid. That crystal's a cloning genius. I'm locked out of my office again. I gotta thank the members of my lab for putting up with me during the filming of that, which was just totally fun, I have to say. Okay,
so
our next segment is brought to you by these new gel electrophoresis cookies.
Are they flavored with ethidium bromide?
And the video game for your phone, Angry Worms. See, those are Drosophila down there.
So it's you.
So last time, Curtis, we talked about different types of graduate students.
Yeah, you know, so it's only fair, I think, this time that we should take a look at the different kinds of PIs. And, you know, maybe we'll give you some advice, some help in choosing your next lab.
The paper factory PI.
Always in their office, writing papers. Writes up everything. Big results, small results, many reviews, commentaries, outlooks, worm readers, gazettes, and method articles.
So the evaluation is go there, but make sure you go for high impact versus MPU.
Yeah.
It's an important consideration.
The paper unfactory PI. hates writing. Everything needs another experiment.
Collaborators refuse to work with him.
Usually get scooped before publishing.
Ouch. Refuses to work on or submit your paper.
Ouch. Evaluation, if you think you can get a job without any publications, go ahead, go work for them.
The postdoc PI.
In the lab more than anyone else.
Knows every protocol, reagent, and construct.
Makes buffers and freezes strains.
Knows worm genetics inside and out.
Ultimately is the font of all lab knowledge.
Evaluation, if you like them, go there because they'll always be there to help.
The invisible PI.
Works out of the house a lot.
When in the office, the door is locked.
Can only reach them by texting or email.
Postpones every lab meeting.
On a dozen study sections and editorial boards.
Otherwise, at a department meeting or teaching.
So evaluation, join if you are good at working independently.
The eternal optimist PI.
Praises everyone for everything.
Loves every result, even if it destroys the favorite hypothesis.
Has at least one PhD candidate that's been there 8 years.
I'm sure he'll manage to finish.
Since they love everything, you can't quite tell where you stand or how you're doing.
Evaluation. Don't worry. Be happy. The total pessimist PI.
No high-impact journal will take this, MS.
The grant score is too low.
The chair and the dean will never support me for tenure.
Good students and postdocs are impossible to get here.
My postdoc will never get a job.
Evaluation, if you end up working here, you'd better be an optimist.
So we tried to pull these things together and give you a sense of what the best PI would be like.
Yeah.
And so we, in this diagram, we think you've got it right in the center there. You know, the combined paper factory, optimist, postdoc, and postdoc PI.
Yeah.
And so the inverse then is going to be the worst PI.
And,
paper, unfactory,
you know,
invisible PI.
This can be
PI,
very difficult.
Total
pessimist. If you get the one right in the middle there, you never know. It just, you could be working for
the devil.
Satan.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you're all thinking about who you work for right now?
Yeah. PIs, are you thinking about
where do
you
fit on those various dimensions?
Okay. All right.
Our next segment is brought to you by the MacBook Air 2D.
So thin, it exists in only two dimensions. And coming July 15th, Harry Potter and the Deathly Lethals Part 2.
So what we'd like to do right now is introduce you to a new satellite television channel that will soon be available that might appeal to people that study worms.
You're watching Worm Network Television, a subsidiary of Wormbase. Tune in this Friday night for a special edition of Talking Shark reading Chromosome 5.
C, D, C, C, G, A, T, T, G, C, D, C, G, C, C, G, T, G, C, T, C, G, G, A, C, D,
That's a special edition of Talking Shark, Friday night at 9 on WNT. Saturday mornings on WNT, tune in for adventures with Dora the Explorer.
Hola, soy Dora. Today we're going to clone a gene. And what do we need to clone a gene? That's right, we need a map. Are you a physical map or a genetic map? Gene map, you're proving yourself to be of limited intellect. If you had just guessed, you had a 50% chance of being right.
I'm the map, I'm the map, I'm the map!
Oh, fuck off, map!
That's Saturday mornings on WNT.
All right. I'd like to thank my kid right there, who was Dora.
Our next segment is brought to you by the new iCloud Worm Strain Storage System.
No need to freeze your stocks, just upload them to the cloud.
Can they add that to Wormbase? And the movie Crazy Pharynx.
So, many of us have been including supplemental videos with papers. This is great, and it's a marvelous way to bring your research to life.
But, you know, sometimes those videos can get a little boring. I mean, this is the age of YouTube, after all.
So we'd like to give you all some suggestions for enhancing your supplemental videos. Yeah. Okay, so number one is to make use of the opportunity to supply some subliminal information into your videos. That could work. Yeah, it could work.
You know, it's a good idea.
There's a chance there. And we often use time lapse to compress very long events into short ones, but why restrict it to developing embryos? Why not,
an important challenge, you know, when you're talking about something? To translate the list of genes generated by genome sequencing into functional maps of the pathways of exocytosis processes. In this paper, our goal is to do this with a set of essential genes in C. elegans.
Get more work done? I mean, it's good.
Functional maps are generated using high-content screening. In a high-content screen, the consequences of inhibiting gene function using RNA interference are captured by scoring a large parameter set. Similar gene function is inferred from similar phenotypes.
I'd like to apologize to Karen for that. And also the opportunity to put in some, you know, extra features, like a director's commentary.
I remember this embryo when we first came in to do a screen test. We were specifically looking for something that had really good POP1 asymmetry, and this one had everything that we needed right off the bat. We only had to film this embryo about 3 times to get it to show that really nice asymmetry there.
Yeah, so, you know, that's a kind of a neat thing that you could be doing. And number four, everything's better with yakety sax. So yeah. You've got, you know, worms moving on a plate, no sound.
Anything's
come on,
you know.
Speed it up. Yeah.
Okay, all you old people recognize this as the theme to Benny Hill.
Of course, we should take advantage of the opportunity to use human models for things. So, for example, here's a punch mutant.
Yeah,
basically. So you could do a roll.
All right, this is the roll phenotype.
And of course, there's the wonderful Steiner-Niemann jumping video, and there's the opportunity to use humans to model that process as well.
Okay, we're dictating.
I gotta thank the Sternberg Lab for those. And last, don't overlook the opportunity to report an unanticipated result.
Reproductive organ, or gonad, which we image at a single time point following gene knockdown.
Gonad architecture depends on the coordination of a broad spectrum of base
pairs. Oh, that makes me laugh. All right, I want to thank these folks for their participation in that.
So, our next segment is brought to you by the Watson and Crick bobbleheads. These are real, you know, you can buy these.
And the award-winning film starring Leonardo DiCaprio, Nociception. It's actually about the bag of worms phenotype, you know, a worm within a worm within a worm. Okay. So here's another look at this new television channel that we're trying to get off the ground.
Up next on WNT, it's Lab Antiques Roadshow.
So, Serena, what do you have for us today?
Well, I found it in the closet of our old lab, and I don't know what it is. I was wondering if you could tell me.
Well, what you have here is a Bio-Rad Model S2. This is a device used for running acrylamide gels. If you ran it for about 4 to 6 hours, you could probably get somewhere between 400 and 600 base pairs of information.
Well, that sounds like a crock of shit to me.
Well, at one time, that was the state of the art.
What can I get for it now?
Well, I don't see the glass plates or the shark's tooth comb, but it's in pretty good condition. I'd say you'd be able to sell this for about $5 to $10.
That's pathetic.
Isn't it?
Do you have a grand deadline? Is your lab empty on weekends? Wouldn't it be great if there was a product that could help? Introducing the new Motivation Air Freshener. Motivation Air Freshener releases powerful stimulants that target the brain's motor and information processing centers while lowering the demand for sleep. Within a few hours, you and your lab will notice the difference.
Warning, this product contains potent amphetamines and psychotropic drugs. Do not take internally. Do not combine with alcohol. Do not give to small animals. May be habit forming. May cause hallucinations and paranoid delusions. May elevate the rate of spontaneous mutations. If someone picks up a weapon and begins uttering threats, leave the area immediately.
Motivation Air Freshener. Do it for your career.
Our next segment is brought to you by Bronze of the Bench Calendar.
And the movie The Overhang, Part 2.
An experiment they'll never forget.
So over the years, I'm sure many of us have seen things in reviews that have made us fuming mad or just laugh out loud.
Yeah, you know, we got to thinking, you know, reviews can be nasty sometimes, but what would they be like if film critics reviewed our papers? What would the really bad ones look like? This isn't a paper. It's a crime against science. You don't so much read it as stare at it and gape jaw disbelief.
A folly so supreme that it occasionally inspires awe in the sense that so many people spend so much time and money on it without ever realizing how awful it is.
It's not just the sound of crickets you hear reading this paper. It's the sound of dead crickets.
The specification of blah, 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 blah. This one actually looks okay.
Looks pretty good.
There's a hidden message in it.
As a paper, it's a piece of garbage, but when considered as a series of figures, many of which are tasteless and tired, but an equal number are inspired, it's worth reading.
The PI is perhaps the only person on Earth who could make a scientist actually nostalgic for the subtle intellectual brilliance of George W. Bush. That's a short review.
Yeah. This is a paper that does roughly the same thing for the concept of cell death that Anthony Weiner does for the concept of good judgment.
This manuscript plumbs new depths for ineptitude in experimentation, writing, rendering of figures, and every other department.
And finally, Vishnu gives this paper 4 thumbs down.
All right, another short video segment brought to you by the Darth Maul Pipetman.
Unleash the power of the dark side.
Your hate has made you powerful.
And the movie CPG Island. Yeah. All right, next segment is just a collection of random thoughts and a public service announcement for you.
Thank you.
now, this public service announcement, brought to you by the worm-based tote bag.
In sexually reproducing species, homologous chromosomes separate from one another so that each gamete carries a single representative of each gene. If this didn't happen, aneuploidy would result. Segregation of allele pairs at meiosis. It's not just a good idea, it's the law.
I love it.
Our two-part finale is brought to you by Fisher Brand Pre-Autoclave Tape.
Instant sterility. Save time and money.
And the Worm PI Plushie Collectibles Collection. Now, many of you may have spotted us at registration and at the first poster session with a video camera.
So what we've been doing is taking your contributions and we've assembled them into a two-part segment we're calling Worm Tube.
So in my lab, we're interested in why worms are different than mice. And we have a model that we believe where one gene makes this animal a worm, and this gene makes it a mouse.
Okay, okay. So this is about the pearl phenotype in C. elegans. So you can see there's like blue pearls here. And then there are these curves which form little rings.
So you can see the sperms start migrating back into the spermatheca. When they are displaced from spermatheca, when it moves on to the uterus, they move back.
Well, what we find is this strange genetic disorder that's occurred in the Q family. And these the Q emperors were originally one of the great noble families from the Far East.
Try one didn't work so good, so we're on try two now. And as you can see, it's a very colorful protein that has lots of different shapes in it.
So, can you tell me, how are you enjoying the fly meeting?
So we wanted to see the effects of jelly bean worms on humans, so we fed them fluorescent worms and then we ran them through their gut and tried to see how they affected the relaxation patterns under the sun. So we counted it with the Brainbow, read the sequence, and then spat out a bunch of data.
So how much are you selling these for?
It's free.
So Todd, can I ask you a question about worm base?
Certainly, yes, please do.
So you're gonna make this thing faster? Cause like sometimes they wait like a half an hour.
Actually, our goal is to make worm base slower.
So, Ken Fry, do you have a worm to go with this pick?
Well, if you've seen the movie Dune or Tremors, maybe there you'd find the worm, but we don't have one here. It's not safe.
So, Tracy, how are you enjoying the worm meeting?
I'm a wormer for life. Worm temporary tattoos here.
Worm temporary tattoos?
That's right.
So, Andy, you sell things to the worm community, the fly community, the yeast community. What's your favorite?
C. elegans rules.
So, Steve.
Yes, sir.
What's with the pool noodles?
You mean these? So, hey, how's it going? This is my poster. As you can see, the controls agree with the theory that we are nothing.
Okay. Jeg vil gerne byde velkommen til den her poster. Det er en meget spændende poster, som er foretaget af mange interessante mennesker. Rent faktisk er godt som en af mine rigtig gode venner.
So Nancy, can you tell us about your poster here?
Most certainly. Notice the anterior-posterior polarity?
So Rebecca, did this happen at the worm meeting?
No, it actually happened a couple of weeks ago. It was a tragedy.
The C. elegans attacked you?
Yeah, it was an angry mob of C. elegans.
This doesn't look good. Okay, folks. It's the big finale, which means it's you. Okay, everybody up. It's time to sing. Sing along. Okay, all right. Up, up, up. Seriously, get up. You all know the song. This Worm Is Your Room by Wormy Guthrie.
the genome sequence to mining modern code. This film was made for you and me. I love an algebra and tested ions to screen the genome with our AI phones. And all around were folks in dulcet tones saying, this film was made for you and me. Your work, this work is my work, from Cambridge, England, to Tokyo, Japan, from ordering coffins, to sending MTAs, this is what was made for you and me. This work is your work.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Well, thank you guys.